number 25, County Attorney.
Mr. Chairman, just for clarification, that's supposed to come?
Yes, sir.
Chairman, this next item pertains to the Forsyth County Ethics Ordinance. There are two issues I want to bring to your attention. The first pertains to the current ethics ordinance requirements with respect to the regular meetings, which currently provides the regular meetings shall occur on the second Tuesdays in May and November. And then the other issue pertains to the calling of special meetings and some issues related to that. I advised the attorney for the ethics board and raised these issues with him, and I'll explain what the issues are in a moment, and he has responded and has requested that we do in fact look at these issues and see if he can we can implement some changes to make the ethics board run better. The first pertains to the regular meetings. Like I said, it's supposed to occur on the second Tuesdays in May and November. At the last November meeting, that did not occur. They did not meet on the date that was called out in the ordinance. I'm not sure exactly why, whether it was the inability to produce a quorum or what the problem was, and they ultimately met sometime thereafter. I think it was in November, but it was not on the second Tuesday. It seems to me, Mr. Chairman, that to the extent that hitting these marks is a problem, we may need to modify the code to give them more latitude if they can't get a quorum for a particular date. I do think it makes sense to have regular meeting dates or at least goals in your ordinance, but I don't know if setting the actual discrete day is working. So perhaps you could give me some authority to go and run legal ads and bring back to you that they still need to meet in May or November, but that shall be up to a determination of the chairman to set the call, the time, and the date, and attempt to fashion a meeting to where it makes sense for all the members to be there. Well, I got one more. The second issue is related, and that pertains to the calling of special meetings, which of course they do need to call, particularly when they have a pending ethics complaint, is they need to be able to call special meetings. There, the ordinance does give the chairman the ability to call the special meetings, which makes sense, but then there's some language further down that says the time of the special meeting is set by a majority of the Board of Ethics, which of course produces a little bit of a circular result, because if the time is to be set by a majority and the chairman can call, how does the chairman call and set the time? Because the time has to be set by, you get the idea, it gets a little convoluted. So if the board would give me direction, I will clean up both these issues and bring it to you in a public hearing.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. I'm going to write that down, Secretary.
That's awesome.
Got it.
Motion and a second. Any discussion? If not, please vote on the motion. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, like sign. There are none. That motion passes unanimously.
Good, guys. Yeah,
The E911 director has requested to address the board relative to the resolution by the Board of Commissioners creating and organizing the Emergency 911 Advisory Board. The last sentence of the fourth paragraph reads, "The current 911 director shall serve as an advisory, non-voting, ex officio member of the board and shall be present at all meetings." Ms. Giordano, the floor is yours.
My request is that be revised to say that I can have a representative, either myself or my designee, be present. And that designee would normally be the assistant director. But there's some, I don't want to limit the time of the meetings because I couldn't be here.
And I'll state for the record, it's my understanding you canceled some airline tickets to be here today, and we appreciate that very much. Let the record show that.
Mr. Chairman, forgive me. The next item I'd like to add, as time sensitive, would be a discussion of the Forsyth County Ethics Ordinance generally, just in light of some of the things that have come up of lately, and as well as some some issues with the code. I would like to just have a discussion on that if the board would allow it.
We have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? If not, please vote on the motion. Those in favor, which is to have a discussion about the ethics. Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed, like sign. There is no opposition. Therefore, that passes unanimously.
Is this the last item, Mr. Chairman?
I believe it is.
Mr. Chairman and members of the board, by way of amendment, I wanted to bring to you basically an eight-minute policy discussion involving the ethics ordinance, and I have basically some general 10,000-foot issues I want to ask you about, and then I want to bring to your attention one issue of a particular potential change to the code. You know, Mr. Chairman, I don't think it's lost on anybody that in the last year or so there have been a lot of issues involving the ethics ordinance. Not only has the board recently or in the not too remote future taken some unilateral action to modify the ethics code. You know, we've adopted the wrongful use provisions, et cetera. Those were unilateral. When I say unilateral, I mean they were not at the urging or a request of the ethics board itself. And then, of course, we've made some changes that were requested by the ethics board and have done that as well. And right now, on your February 2nd agenda, we have yet additional modifications made by or requested by the ethics board, quite frankly, with some input from myself as well. And to the extent that the ethics ordinance is challenging to comply with, is challenging procedurally, and presents some, I guess you'd say, some administrative hurdles, that's a county problem. That's a problem with me, to the extent that that exists. I don't know what the answer is, and to the extent that, you know, the Board of Commissioners would like to maybe have me reach out to the Board of Ethics and see if we need to start a dialogue and perhaps some much more substantive changes to the entirety of the code, maybe in fact a new paradigm with respect to how it's done. Maybe they could provide us some input on that. Maybe you'd like me to go out and speak with them and bring you back some recommendations. I wanted to have this discussion. I don't know that we have set the table with 7 minutes left for this discussion to occur.
I think it's worth considering, you know, some sort of certification for them. If you're a member of the ethics board, just throwing that out there, that counselor, you're well-versed in this statutes, and, you know, when you get appointed or nominated to the ethics board,
Well, I don't have to tell any of you that the stakes are high. I mean,
sure.
this, you know, an ethics board is a good board. The ethics ordinance is a big deal, and those who administer it have a big responsibility. And we need to make sure that we give them the tools to succeed and to do it right and to make sure that those that are in the process are treated fairly. I think that's everyone's objective. And to the extent that that's not happening, if you perceive that's not happening, then I need to help you and the board make that happen. So I want to lay that out to you, and we may not have time to get into the weeds on this today. This may be an item for the next work session. If it is, let's postpone that. But I want to at least raise it. It's out there. Yes, sir.
Thank you, Counselor. Do you think that this is an item that maybe, you know, February 14th, what, 3 weeks away? Do we need another work session between now and the 14th?
There's two issues that, and I don't mean to suggest this elevates to the water contract. I'm sorry, I don't think it's there. But there are a couple of issues I heard today that suggest to me may need some interaction between the next 3 weeks or within the next 3 weeks. Water contract is.
I think the board ought to consider, you know, maybe one on the 7th or moving the 14th up to the 7th instead of waiting 3 weeks. And I think that's just adding. If we knock it out on the 7th, we don't have to come on the 14th. Well,
the days of the month work out.
Do I hear a motion?
Well,
that's the week we've got the work session and the regular meeting in the same week. It would be helpful to staff, if it makes sense to the board, to move the 14th to the 7th.
How about all these things we delayed to the 14th? We have to go back and do them, or can't?
Things we've delayed to the 14th, if you call a special meeting, I think within our rules, you could add agenda items, and at that meeting, we could take them off the 14th.
Mm-hmm.
Just add it in the ordinance?
Let's do that. Why don't we just do?
Yeah, just add a work session.
What's this other?
Well, the other issue that I wanted to bring, it's not a policy issue, it's a practical issue. You know, to the extent that we rework the code, or if we are, and you've not told me that we are, but I know that I've already got some board members that don't like some of our conflict of interest transactions language, and I have proposed to you some modifications to that, and if we had time, I'd like to walk you through it very quickly before we move, before we close out the agenda. If you look, do you see that everybody have the handout that I gave you, section 283? Section A makes a whole lot of sense. Okay, section A provides that no official or employee shall acquire or maintain an interest in a contract or transaction if a reasonable basis exists that such an interest will be affected directly by his or her official action. Makes sense. The ethics ordinance is intended to ensure that people are making decisions objectively, correct? And so, to the extent that A says that, that makes a great deal of sense. Now go to B. Then you have a statement that says the county shall enter into a contract involving services or property with an official or employee or with a business entity in which the official or employee has an interest, period. All right, all of a sudden, B takes the element of conflict out of it. It simply is a per se carte blanche rule. And the feedback I have heard is while there may be a lot of instances where that makes sense, the rule expressed in B is inconsistent with A because A is looking to see if a true conflict exists to the extent that an official can enter into a contract. B doesn't worry about whether you have a problem or not or a conflict or not. It paints a per se rule, and to that end, perhaps it needs some modification. Okay, and that's the feedback I've heard, because what it may do ultimately is impair the ability of the county to enter into contracts that individuals that happen to be officials or employees happen to have, you know, with companies that it may make sense to do business with, even if that individual has nothing to do with the decision-making process. Does that make sense? Has no official activity whatsoever to do.
Which would create the conflict.
If they don't have any official activity with respect to the contract, then what's the conflict? That's the point that's been made to me.
In the interest of time,
Well, I'll want to go over it with you again in the public hearing in great detail. But yes, what I've tried to do is set a check and balance in here that accomplishes the ability to make sure that there's an actual conflict before someone is disqualified from doing business with the county.
Can we make motion to put this on the February 2nd?
February 2nd.
I'll second that.
No,
you
made a motion.
I made a motion to put it on February 2nd.
We have a motion and a second to put the whole ethics thing or just this section? This section on to the February 2nd meeting. If there's no discussion, please vote on the motion. Those in favor say aye. Aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, like sign.
Don't need to make a motion to have a public hearing on the 7th.
Work session, just do it, make it clean.
Well, no, yeah, I mean, forgive me, I didn't check my calendar quick enough. Listen, I can't get it advertised by that quickly.
So, you
want
to make it on that?
I've got to have 15 days once I get the ad.
We're talking about the 2nd.
No, the 7th.
There is a
work session on the 7th. The work
session.
I need a public hearing.
Right.
That's 15 days out.
He's talking about the work. We just put something on the public hearing, and it's not enough time for him to advertise. It has nothing to do with the work session.
You all need to reconsider the vote you just took, please.
Okay. I call
make
for a reconsideration.
Motion 16. Reconsider the previous vote.
Okay, and let's restate the motion, please.
Motion to reconsider the motion to place this on the February 2nd public hearing.
Yes. Okay. And do we have a second for that?
16.
Second. We have a motion and a second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed, like sign. That was no opposition. Now, can we restate?
If I make a motion that we put this on February 16th. Have a public hearing on February 16th.
Second.
Okay.
We have a motion and a second. There's no discussion. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
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 All those opposed, like sign. There's no opposition. That carries. Public hearing. This is the first reading of the proposed amendment to the Forsyth County Ethics Ordinance.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, this evening we have a first public reading of a proposed modification of Forsyth County Ordinance number 77 which is the Forsyth County Code of Ethics. This is something that was very briefly discussed in a prior work session. I was given the authority to proceed forward to a public hearing, which this evening is the first. There is no opportunity to take official action with respect to this evening. These modifications consist of primarily two modifications in the conflicted conflict of interest transaction language in the code. If you'll look in your agenda packet on page 1, you'll see a subparagraph A at the bottom, which contains a fairly clear statement that no official or employee shall acquire or maintain an interest in any contract or transaction or reasonable basis exists that such an interest will be affected directly by his official act or action. The issue was raised to me that this carries with it the very sort of conflicted interest in official act or action which our ethics code is intended to prohibit. The language goes on further to say that the employee or official may take no action with respect to official acts or actions which the official or employee has a reasonable opportunity to influence. That is less clear with respect to the meaning of that, but the first section is quite clear. The whole purpose of the conflict of interest section is to ensure that official actions are taken without anything other than objective standards controlling. The concern that was raised was with respect to A and B, because B contains a much broader prohibition. The county shall not enter into any contract involving services or property with an official or employee or with a business entity in which the official or employee has an interest, period. What is omitted from that section is there being an actual conflict of interest with respect to that, and that was the issue that was raised to me, and that was what I was asked to see if we could get around or see if we could deal with. Here is the language that I have put together to try and deal with that concern. The county shall not enter into any contract involving services or property with an official or employee or with a business entity in which the official or employee has an interest. Where the official or employee is obligated or authorized to take an official act or duty related to awarding or approving of that contract, again, trying to tailor it such that the prohibition pertains to if the official has an affirmative action under law to take action with respect to that contract. This prohibition shall apply even if the official or employee abstains from taking an official act or duty with respect to the contract. The county may enter into a contract with a business entity or official or employee has an interest in the entity, so long as, number one, the official or employee has no obligation or authorization to take an official act, as we discussed. Number two, the contract is awarded by way of a competitive procurement process. Number three, the employee or official discloses to procurement personnel his or her affiliation with the county. Number four, the employee or official affirms in writing to procurement personnel that he or she is neither soliciting nor receiving an advantage, favor, or influence with respect to the contract due to affiliation with the county. And number five, the contract is not otherwise prohibited by law. Those bullet points are aimed at addressing, first of all, safeguards to ensure that if the county does in fact entertain a contract with the individual or entity that has an interest, that it's done with some transparency and with some affirmations that there's been no use of their position in the county to advance their interests. Mr. Chairman, this is the first reading. And there will be no opportunity to take action this evening.
Is there anyone? Do I have a motion to open the public hearing?
So moved.
Second. A motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote on the motion. That passes unanimously. Is there anyone who wishes to speak in favor of this item? Is there anyone who wishes to speak in opposition to this item? Please come down, sir.
My name is Harold Bennett. It's the first time I've been to a commission meeting. I've been a faithful resident of this county now for 8 years. I was 23 years a member or investigator of the medical examiner's office in Lake County and the cop. I am now retired from that position. The one reason I moved up here is because Forsyth County has been progressing leaps and bounds moving into the next century as far as, you know, being ahead of other areas. This particular case, though, has brought me a problem. And being quite honest, I plan on running for the position of coroner of this county in this election. I was told the day that I announced this by another person who was running that there was no need for me to run because he already had commission approval from the county attorney's approval to proceed, even though he has a county contract to operate. But him being coroner and also holding a contract with this county, I think would be in a direct conflict of interest for him, because he was saying to benefit from it financially. Whether it be one time or 100 times. The difference is the way it's written. Now he cannot obtain that position because it would interfere with the way he runs his business. So he can give up his contract and run, or he can not run and keep his contract. That's all I have, Sarah. I'm not going to throw any names out or anything. I just wanted to bring this point up that other counties throughout the state of Georgia, and I've been dealing 23 years in the medical examiner's office, I know that this is a sore point in a lot of areas. So I'd like to see Forsyth County stay ahead of the game and not permit something like this to happen. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there anyone else who wishes to speak in opposition? If not, is there a motion to close the public hearing?
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes unanimously. Old business, number one. Do we have a need of an executive session?
No, Mr. Chair.
Do I hear a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote on the issue. That passes unanimously. We are adjourned at 6:02 p.m.
The Forsyth County Ethics Ordinance. These are modifications that were discussed in the prior work session with direction given to me to advertise for modification. These are in the nature of procedural modifications as to how the Board of Ethics calls both its regular and special meetings. If you'll look at your agenda packet, you'll see the bottom of the first page. The Board of Ethics shall have 2 regular meetings per year, and the meetings shall occur. The language presently reads on the second Tuesday in the month of May and November. However, based upon some concerns with respect to the Board of Ethics being able to assemble on those sorts of discrete days, the Board of Commissioners has indicated a willingness to open that up a little bit, such that the new language would say that they will meet on the months of May and November on dates and times to be set and called by the chairperson of the Board of Ethics, therefore giving more latitude with respect to the meeting days. The second paragraph, or the, I guess in the second page, rather, pertains to special meetings. Special meetings of the Forsyth County Board of Ethics may be called in the dates and times of same set either by majority vote of the Board of Ethics at any duly held meeting or by call of the chairperson at any time. Once again, this would take away language that required that the time of the special meetings be set by a board vote. That was procedurally awkward And this will at least open it up if the chairperson can set a time and date for a special meeting as well. This is a first public reading this evening, Mr. Chairman. After the public hearing, the board is not entitled to take action. If you wish to adopt, it will be after the second public hearing in March. Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Chair would entertain a motion to open the public hearing on this item.
I move.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes unanimously. Is there anyone here this evening who would like to speak in favor of this item? Is there anyone here who would like to speak in opposition? Okay. Seeing none, the chair would entertain a motion to close the public hearing.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote on this issue. And that passes unanimously. Public hearing. This is the first reading of the proposed amendment to Forsyth County Ethics Ordinance.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, this evening we have a first public reading of the proposed modification of Forsyth County Ordinance Number 77, which is the Forsyth County Code of Ethics. This is something that was very briefly discussed in a prior work session. I was given the authority to proceed forward to a public hearing, of which this evening is the first. There is no opportunity to take official action with respect to this evening. These modifications consist of primarily two modifications in the conflict of interest transaction language in the code. If you look in your agenda packet on page 1, you'll see a subparagraph A at the bottom, which contains a fairly clear statement that no official or employee shall acquire or maintain an interest in any contract or transaction where reasonable basis exists that such an interest will be affected directly by his official act or action. The issue was raised to me that this carries with it the very sort of conflicted interest in official act or action which our ethics code is intended to prohibit. The language goes on further to say that the employee or official may take no action with respect to official acts or actions which the official or employee has a reasonable opportunity to influence. That is less clear with respect to meaning that, but the first section is quite clear. The whole purpose of the conflict of interest section is to ensure that official actions are taken without anything other than objective standards controlling. The concern that was raised was with respect to A and B, because B contains a much broader prohibition. County shall not enter into any contract involving services or property with an official or employee or with a business entity in which the official or employee has an interest, period. What is omitted from that section is there being an actual conflict of interest with respect to that, and that was the issue that was raised to me, and that was what I was asked to see if we could get around or see if we could deal with. Here is the language that I have put together to try and deal with that concern. The county shall not enter into any contract involving services or property with an official or employee or with a business entity in which the official or employee has an interest, where the official or employee is obligated or authorized to take an official act or duty related to awarding or approving of that contract. Again, trying to tailor it such that the prohibition pertains to if the official has an affirmative action under law to take action with respect to that contract. This prohibition shall apply even if the official or employee abstains from taking an official act or duty with respect to the contract. The county may enter into a contract with a business entity where official or employee has an interest in the entity, so long as, number one, the official or employee has no obligation or authorization to take an official act, as we discussed. Number two, the contract is awarded by way of a competitive procurement process. Number three, the employee or official discloses to procurement personnel his or her affiliation with the county. Number four, the employee or official affirms in writing to procurement personnel that he or she has neither solicited nor received any advantage, favor, or influence with respect to the contract due to affiliation with the county. And number five, the contract is not otherwise prohibited by law. Those bullet points are aimed at addressing, first of all, safeguards to ensure that if the county does in fact entertain a contract with the individual or entity that has an interest, that it's done with some transparency and with some affirmations that there's been no use of their position in the county to advance their interests in the community. Mr. Chairman, this is the first reading, and there will be no opportunity to take action this evening.
Is there anyone, do I have a motion to open the public hearing?
So moved.
Second. Motion and second. If there's no discussion, please vote on the motion. That passes unanimously. Is there anyone who wishes to speak in favor of this item? Is there anyone who wishes to speak in opposition to this item? Please come down, sir.
My name's Harold, and it's the first time I've been to a commission meeting. I've been a faithful resident of this county now for 8 years. I was 23 years a member or investigator of the medical examiner's office with Lorne County and the cop. I'm now retired from that position. The one reason I moved up here is because Forsyth County has been progressing leaps and bounds moving into the next century as far as, you know, being ahead of other areas. This particular case, though, has brought me a problem, and being quite honest, I plan on running for the position of coroner of this county in this election. I was told the day that I announced this by another person who was running that there was no need for me to run because he already had commission approval from and county attorney's approval to proceed, even though he has a county contract to operate. But him being coroner and also holding a contract with this county, I think would be in a direct conflict of interest for him, because he was saying to benefit from it financially, whether it be one time or 100 times. The difference is the way it's written. Now he cannot obtain that position because it would interfere with the way he runs his business. So he can give up his contract and run, or he can not run and keep his contract. That's all I have, Sarah. I'm not going to throw any names out or anything. I just wanted to bring this point up that other counties throughout the state of Georgia, and like I said, the dealing 23 years in the medical examiner's office, I know that this is a sore point in a lot of areas. So I'd like to see Forsyth County stay ahead of the game and not permit something like this to happen. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there anyone else who wishes to speak in opposition? If not, is there a motion to close the public hearing?
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes unanimously.
We have 4 public comment speakers this evening. Our first speaker is Brent Meadows.
This evening, I have a prior engagement that I'm going to leave right after my comments, but I'm going to speak on ethics this evening. Now that your schedule has been cleared to a certain degree, I'm hopeful that you will have some time to devote to ethics, and particularly the dilemma of the Forsyth County Board of Ethics. Now is a good time to consider corrective action. I personally have experience with the Board of Ethics and have also served on two county boards. Currently, the Board of Ethics is before the courts to resolve a dilemma with the Board of Ethics rules. The state of Georgia is embarking on an overhaul of sunshine laws, and I'm hopeful that you will consider overhauling the Forsyth County ethics rules. As you are aware, many rule changes have already taken place, but these changes have only been a band-aid approach. Please consider the following should you choose to embark on an overhaul. First, the board makeup. Currently, the board is made up of fellow Forsyth County residents. Inevitably, the board seems to get mired in politics. Possibly consider a board comprised of attorneys from the indigent defense pool of another county to avoid politics. They are currently having concerns about political participation by ethic board members. Two current board members of the Board of Ethics have liked politicians on their Facebook page. This is a violation of ethics rules. Other political involvement appears to have occurred also, which leads me to my next suggestion. Education, training, and testing of ethics board members and staff. Without training and testing, we can expect others to fall victim to the board that, simply put, doesn't know their own rules. Finally, please consider establishing a committee of stakeholders to recommend to you revisions and corrective action up to and including the elimination of the Board of Ethics. The Forsyth County Board of Ethics should set the example for all other boards, and they should not be the poster child of how to do it wrong. Thank you.
Thank you. We're now at a second reading of the proposed amendment for Forsyth County Ethics Ordinance.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, you have in front of you this evening a second public hearing with respect to proposed modifications for Forsyth County Ordinance Number 77, the Forsyth County Ethics Code. This pertains to technical requirements of the ordinance, particularly with respect to how both special and regular meetings are set. You'll see in your agenda packet on page one that currently a regular meeting has to occur on the second Tuesday in the month of May and November. We have attempted to further distill that such that there is no specific day, but the regular meetings must occur on May and November on dates and times to be set and called by the chairperson of the Board of Ethics, again, to provide greater flexibility on scheduling for this board. The next page of your agenda packet basically accomplishes the same thing with respect to special meetings, which may be called in the dates and times the same set by majority vote of the board, or by call of the chairperson. Once again, to give greater flexibility for the Board of Ethics to be able to call both regular and special meetings when they can otherwise get a quorum together. Mr. Chairman, this is a second reading of this ordinance this evening. The board may adopt.
Thank you, Council. Chair will entertain a motion to open the public hearing.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote on the motion. That passes unanimously. Is there anyone here this evening wishing to speak in favor of this amendment? Anyone here wishing to speak in opposition? Hearing none, do I hear any motion to close the public hearing?
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes unanimously. Tonight we can adopt this if we wish, Tim.
You can, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Chairman, I make a motion we adopt the proposed amendments to the Forsyth County Ethics Ordinance 77-B regarding meeting procedures seconded by County Attorney.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes unanimously. Item three is a second reading of an amendment to Forsyth County Ethics Ordinance as well.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, you have before you this evening a second modification of the proposed ethics ordinance pertaining to conflicts of interest transaction. There should be two pages in your agenda packet that contain the proposed modifications. This was a matter where the board authorized me on January 24th to commence legal ads based upon concerns raised with respect to some of the language. If you look on section 1A of your agenda packet, you will see this language: no official or employee shall acquire or maintain an interest in the contract or transaction if a reasonable basis exists that such an interest would be affected directly by his official act or action. That language in an ethics ordinance is appropriate because what it suggests is that the official, if their interest is affected by a contract, therefore they have an ethical and legal impediment to acting. Therefore, it certainly reads an ethical conflict into the code. It's a clear statement of intent that the ethical propriety of the official's action is at center of stage. If you go to page 2, the current language provides in 2B, make sure I said that right, in section 1B, forgive me, on page 2 of your packet, it contains a per se prohibition, or what I would call a bright line rule. The county shall not enter into any contract involving services or property with an official or employee or with a business entity in which the official or employee has an interest, period. There is no concern given with respect to the ethical considerations of whether the employee or official has in fact an ethical conflict. As stated before, it is simply a bright line rule. It takes the ethical question out of the equation, and that was the concern expressed to me, and that was the basis upon which these modifications were proposed. What I have placed in front of you is a modification that would allow the county to enter into a contract with an entity for which has an official or employee as part of that entity, so long as the following things were accomplished. First of all, if the official or employee is obligated or authorized to take an official act, as you do when you vote on contracts, there would be no entitlement for the county to enter into a contract in that situation. However, if the employee or official had no obligation to take official action, the county could enter into that sort of contract in the following situations. First of all, the official or employee must have no obligation to take official action. Number two, the contract must be awarded by way of a competitive procurement process. Number three, the official or employee having the interest must notify procurement staff of the interest. Number four, they must certify that they have not used their influence with the county to achieve any sort of favoritism or advantage with respect to the procurement process, and the contract must otherwise not be prohibited by law. Again, the concern that has been, or that was expressed to me by board members, was that there may be contracts that the county does in fact wish to either remain in or enter into with entities that have an official or employee of the county involved in that entity, but they can't because of this bright line rule. That's what I'm bringing for you this evening. Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Counselor. What's the pleasure of the board? I'll entertain a motion to open the public hearing.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote on the motion, which carries unanimously. Is there anyone wishing to speak in favor of this amendment? Is there anyone wishing to speak in opposition to this? So does the chair hear a motion to close the public hearing?
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion.
Mr. Chairman, I would move that we postpone the decision on this 2 weeks to the March 15th meeting.
Have a motion. I will second for discussion if no one else will. Ken, as I understand it, right now we sort of have a very large bright line here in which prison can't have a contract and the employee of the county. Is that correct?
It's a bright line rule.
And,
I think we've got an employee that has a contract. As an elected official, as an assessment, they're in violation of that for years. What's the purpose for postponement?
I would just like further time to digest what's before us.
Ken, do you think this makes this a better ordinance, this language we're adding, or are we trying to do something
I think it makes it a different ordinance.
Not necessarily better.
Yeah. Forgive me. I mean, it's different, and it certainly provides greater flexibility if that's where the board wants to go.
Is it more in line with other counties, their ordinance, or is that all ordinance more?
I haven't researched that, and if the board would like me to take a look at other jurisdictions to see if they have similar sorts of language, I'd be happy to. And forgive me for not having done that.
Just for me, if you might, one of my concerns, I guess, would have been, and as I was looking into this, because I asked a lot of questions, We have an employee that offers a service or a product the county's wish interest to engage in a contract with at this point in time, even if they had better product for a lesser dollar or a low bidder, we wouldn't be allowed to use that, would we?
That's correct. Which was one of the concerns raised to me specifically.
It's a detriment. I think the five items that you have granted are pretty clear. I don't know how much more there is to digest, really, something like this. It seems pretty clear. I think sometimes we spend too much time on it to see what others are doing. That doesn't always, you know, we talked about that the other day with an issue. It seems pretty clear.
Are they in a rush, too? I mean, does he interfere in the lady 2 weeks with anything?
I don't know if that's it. I mean, we've just spent about 2.5 to 3 months now, and it kind of, I guess I wonder why here at 5:45 on the night of the public hearing we cannot digest it. And, you know, it takes task staff time to go back through it, and just to me, a waste of time. It's certainly up to this board.
I guess we had a work session discussion on this, and we voted on to send it to a public hearing. We've had two public hearings already.
We had, yes, sir. We have a motion and a second on the floor. If there's no further discussion about the motion to postpone, what day was that, Brian?
2 weeks, March 15th.
To postpone until March 15th. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 3-2. So this is postponed decisions on March 15th. Old business. Approval for amendments to the Forsyth County Ethics Ordinance. Sharon entertains a motion.
Mr. Chairman, do you want me to present briefly?
Yes, please. Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, you have in front of you this evening a proposed modification to Forsyth County Ordinance 77, the Forsyth County Ethics Code. This is not a public hearing this evening, as the board has already had the required two public hearings. This item is before you for decision only. This would be a modification to the conflict of interest transaction section of the code that would allow for the county to enter into contracts involving services of property with an official or employee or with a business entity in which the official or employee has an interest, so long as five different criteria are met. I will read them and then I will turn it back over to the board. The five criteria have to be that, number one, the official or employee has no obligation or authorization to take an official act with respect to the contract, number one. Number two, the contract is or was awarded by way of a competitive procurement process. Number three, the employee or official discloses to procurement personnel his or her affiliation with the county. Number four, the employee or official affirms in writing to procurement personnel that he or she has neither solicited nor received any advantage, favor, or influence with respect to the contract due to affiliation with the county. And number five, the contract is not otherwise prohibited by law. This would be a fairly significant modification to the code, as right now there is a bright line rule that would not permit this activity. Mr. Chairman, I think the matter is to the board.
Thank you, Counselor. The chair would entertain a motion regarding this.
Mr. Chairman, did you review it? You wanted to delay it last time. Are you comfortable with it now?
I'm not asking you to delay it this time.
Mr. Chairman, I make a motion. We approve the amendments to the Forsyth County Ethics Ordinance 77-B as reflected by our attorney.
Second.
We have a motion and we have a second. Is there any discussion? If there's no discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 3-2.
We have two public comment speakers signed up this evening. Our first speaker is Dr. Joe Moses.
My name is Joe Moses. I live here in Forsyth County. I have no financial interest in the topic on which I'll be speaking, and I'm speaking for no one except myself. With all due apologies to my friend, Forsyth County Attorney Mr. Ken Jarrard, for giving him no prior notice of the message to be delivered by Attorney Frank Jenkins tonight, I hope that he will understand. Mr. Jenkins has practiced government law for over 25 years. In his practice, he has handled in excess of 100 litigation cases concerning local government issues, including suits involving water use. Mr. Jenkins has been involved in the preparation and drafting of zoning and development law at both the state and local level. Among his many accomplishments is that he was selected to serve two terms as chairman of the DeKalb County Ethics Board. It's my distinct pleasure to introduce Mr. Frank Jenkins.
Mr. Chairman, members of the commission, I'm here to, in fairness to the commission, to advise of our contention that there is a conflict of interest among your commissioners in voting on the water contract, that either the extension or the water contract itself. That is that Commissioner Pete Amos, who owns a water company that buys water from the county and serves as one of his businesses in the county, a water contract between the city and the county would directly affect his business and his business interests.
Mr. Chairman, I object, sir. You're not to address a commissioner by name, and they know that.
That is true. So noted. Please continue to try not to refer to any commissioner by name.
Well, that is my contention, is that there is a conflict of interest. We know from the Supreme Court cases that a private citizen of a county has a right to contest a vote of a commission in which any commissioner has a conflict of interest. And a conflict of interest, the Supreme Court tells us, arises when there is a business interest by any member of the commission which is affected directly by the matters that come before the commission, and if there's a vote, or even if there's an intent to influence the vote. And we wish to tell the commission in advance of our intent. We have a right to sue, which we intend to do if necessary. And the courts have repeatedly, I will say, reversed or nullified any decision which any member of the commission has with a conflict of interest as voted.
Thank you.
Our next speaker.
In this case, can you go ahead and do it?
I'll say it.
It doesn't feel right. All right.
Mr. Chair, since my name is mentioned by someone in the audience, I'd like to make a statement this time. I'm aware that certain members of the community have raised concerns with my participation in the city water contract. As I understand it, these concerns are mainly due to my ownership of a company that purchases water from the county. The fact is, my company buys water from both the county and the city, and through its purchases, I do not purchase much more water from the county. And my company is simply a water customer, same as any other water customer in the county. My company gets no special treatment in these purchases. Because my company is just a water customer, I do not believe I have a conflict of interest in the water issue. I know I can make a decision regarding the city-county water contracts that is in the best interest of all my constituents and the county. So therefore, I will not accuse myself of any vote. I plan to represent my district as well as any water contracts negotiated this time. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. Okay, we have a motion and a second.
Mr. Chairman, before we take a vote, I'll give my written statement into record.
Yes, sir.
This is a statement from Pete Amos. On record, with respect to the city county water contracts, I have given the allegations I have. With respect to the city water, I have given the allegations that I have a conflict of interest
considerable thought since it was discussed last Thursday night. While I maintain my position that I do not have a conflict of interest, I believe the water contract issue is too important an issue to leave this outcome to chance, or for me to take an official action on the contract and then find the county on the other side of a lawsuit, a needless lawsuit, that seems to undo the county's decision. Therefore, in an effort to ensure that I've done everything within my power to provide the public confidence that I can legitimately take action on these very important issues, I wish to announce that in the next couple of days, I will deliver to the Forsyth County Board of Ethics a request for an advisory opinion. The question that the Board of Ethics issue a determination as to whether a conflict of interest either disqualifies me for the existing water contract issue. And until the Board of Ethics reaches a decision, I will conditionally and temporarily recuse myself from taking any action on the water contracts. When the Board of Ethics renders an advisory opinion, I will then conduct myself in a manner consistent with this decision. It's my statement, and I will recuse myself on any vote on water today.
Thank you.
Any vote on postponing the meeting, the special call meeting?
In light of that, I would request you not do that.
Okay, that's right.
Thank you.
Items for consideration, number one, county raw and finished water contracts. Commissioner Bell and Tam, your name is on the agenda.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. You want to say a statement or whatever you do?
I just want to say again, I'm recusing myself in this vote at this moment. Discussion and vote.
Is that good enough, Counselor?
It is.
Thank you.
Is that why you wait for the Ethics Board to...
Yes, sir. We're going to
offer an opinion?
Yes, sir. We're going to appeal this to Ethics Board and get an opinion from them.
Okay.
Can Pete have one to even look at? He can look at it. Yes.
Just don't read it.
Just don't speak. All right. Give it to yourself.
Yeah, read it.
Yes.
Next item under new business is the upcoming Board of Ethics elections for positions held by Mr. Tim Perry, who is the appointee of the elected officials in the county, and Dr. Rusty Ricketson, who is the full-time employees appointee. Zachary, do you want to address that?
Yes, sir. Both of their terms end July the 1st, and neither one has decided to seek to hold this to be appointed again. So the elected officials have provided nominations with which I've spoken with their nominee, and he is thinking about it. And then today is the deadline for the employees to submit their nominees. When they submit the two I've got, will be contacted to provide biographical information, and then it will go out to the employees, and I anticipate a vote in about 2 weeks. And it's in order to get on to the June work sessions so that they can be confirmed by the Board of Commissioners by the time that, of July 1st.
Okay, so the positions expire as of July 1st?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to address that if I may. As you know, I'm the appointee of the county elected officials, not including the Board of Commissioners. That includes the following offices: the district attorney, probate judge, clerk of court, sheriff, tax commissioner, the coroner, the chief magistrate, solicitor general, both superior court judges, and both state court judges. And I've served 5 2-year terms. And at the end of this, my 10th year, it'll conclude my service to Board of Ethics. And I just want to say to the board, and certainly to the elected officials that elected me to represent them on this board for the last 10 years, I always consider community service an honor, and it's I just appreciate the opportunity. I've tried to serve on this board with integrity and honesty, and I just appreciate the opportunity to serve with all of you, appreciate the opportunity to represent the elected officials.
Well, thank you very much, and certainly you you and Dr. Ricketson both have been on the board from the time I got here several years back, and I believe since the board's inception. So we certainly thank you for your dedicated service, probably longer than most folks would serve on a volunteer board. So,
well, Mr. Chairman, let me just piggyback on what Tim said and say it has been an honor to serve the people of Forsyth County, especially the full-time employees of Forsyth County, serving on this board at its inception and watching how it has matured and grown. And so I just want to thank you all for your participation and being a part of this endeavor.
Very good. Well, thank you again for your service. Really, really appreciate it. I know it can be a thankless job sometimes, but I appreciate both of you serving as long as you have. In fact, I would like to make a motion that we recognize and formally thank both Mr. Perry and Dr. Ricketson for their long and dedicated service to the board. We have a motion. We have a second. We have a motion and second. All in favor of formally recognizing? Yes, Mr. Trump. That moves. Passes by 3 votes.
You didn't want to recognize yourself.
Three to two.
Exactly. Well, thank you again. It's very, very much appreciated. All right. That closes out our advisory opinion. And I guess we should just, before we leave that entirely, let's clarify a little bit of the detail around that. You're going to go ahead and draft a letter, and that will be then mailed to the commissioner?
I would anticipate the letter stating this is being written as a courtesy to give him some insight as to what the board decided today, the minutes of the board, how the actual ruling, but that the board found that because of his involvement with ANA Water, it is a direct financial interest conflict, and the board recommends him abstaining or recusing himself from these negotiations for that. In regards to the second two, the board discussed in and of themselves, you don't find it to be a conflict, but due to your decision under the first prong, you've decided that the conflict exists as to that. That's what I anticipate the letter saying on behalf of the board.
Should we provide a recommendation or just tell them how we would rule?
Well, I mean, I think if you find that it's a conflict, the rules say you're to abstain and recommend that he follow that rule.
Okay.
I don't think there was a problem with you advising that.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's our advisory opinion. I think we have to be clear on what it is. I don't know if that forces him to do that, but nonetheless, we want to be clear with our opinions. So.
Right, I think it's fine to do that.
Okay, thank you.
Now item 3, I believe.
Yes, commissioners, this is a request for the appointment of the employee's representative for the Forsyth County Board of Ethics. Nominations were accepted from all full-time employees through May 4th. Two nominations were tendered. One nomination accepted and another nominee declined. The incumbent, Dr. Ricketson, had chosen not to renew his term. That resulted in a single candidate being nominated as the employee representative. As such, the employee vote for a single nominee did not occur, and they're declared the winner. Therefore, the full-time employees are requesting that the Board of Commissioners appoint Mr. Charles Laughinghouse as a nominee for the position for the employee representative for a two-year term that would begin July 1st, 2012, and run through June 30th, 2015.
Pat, when was the announcement made to the employees?
It was announced, I believe, you mean for the nominees?
Right. Wasn't it April 27th that went out to the employees?
That sounds about right. I don't know the exact date.
And they were taken through May 4th?
Yes.
Which was 7 days. But according to the Ethics Code, Section 2.11.12a, Kenneth can check me on this, that the employees are supposed to be given 30 days to submit nominations, and they were only given 7. So I'm going to make a motion and send this back to the employees.
Let me check that.
Do you say who the other person was? Do you, are you allowed to say that out loud?
I don't actually remember.
Oh, okay.
I don't.
And for what reason?
He chose not to.
No, but you said there were two people.
No, one chose not to do it.
Well, one chose not to do it.
Yeah, he didn't accept the nomination.
But the ethics ordinance says that they have 30 days, which then the county manager is supposed to notify the board of commissioners within 5 days. And then, in all reality, it then goes to the next regular meeting of the board of commissioners, not a work session.
Well, then we better follow the ordinance.
So we need to follow the ordinance. So therefore, I make a motion that we send it back to the employees to reopen nominations for an additional 23 days.
Let's just wait for him to verify.
So is it the case that the appointment or the nomination process was not open for 30 days?
7.
It was open for 1 week, for about 7 days.
It was opened on the 27th and closed on the 4th.
I believe it was. She has gone the Tuesday.
Well, I mean, Section 2, 1112A does say that the body or individuals notified shall have 30 days in which to conduct their appointment process and provide the county manager with the name of their appointment.
Does that also hold true for all nominees?
Well, what it says, that has to do with the initial appointment process. But then it says in B that all appointments following the expiration of the initial term shall proceed as set forth in Section A, which is the initial process. So it would seem to wrap back up into it again. So it would appear that a 30-day open nomination process appears to be accurate.
The last thing we want to do is not follow that.
I agree.
We need to start over, just scrap it and reopen them for 30 days.
Would the 30 days start from the beginning, or do you use that first week?
Well, if we're going to start the process over again, it would probably make sense just to start it, yeah.
Okay.
For both the elected officials and the employees, then, because they were both already open.
And that, for the record, is the item 4, the elected officials and the employee representative. And then,
Ken, do you have anything further to add to that?
Mm-hmm. That appears accurate, Mr. Chairman.
So then they need to do that, and then they have to notify the Board of Commissioners within 5 days of who has been elected.
I will tell you, I'm not concerned about it being in a regular meeting, because anything we do here has to go to the regular meeting to be approved anyway. Okay. So I don't mind the nominees being discussed here, but it's going to have to be approved.
It has to be approved at the regular.
That's correct.
But it doesn't have to come to a work session.
It doesn't have to. It just says that the board shall.
It can go directly to a regular meeting.
That's correct. Regular meeting. Might as well go and put it on a regular meeting.
Okay. Do we need a vote or anything?
I don't know. Is that a motion or?
For the record, I would prefer just a motion to basically reinstitute the process.
Mr. Chairman, I make a motion we not accept the employee representative, Charlie Rackinghouse, or the elected representative, elected officials representative, nominations not open long enough, and that we send it back to the ethics board to start the process.
Let me ask you this question, and I know you got to make a second. Would it be appropriate, though, given that those nominations did occur during what was believed to be that they'd be put back into the pool?
I think whoever nominated them can just put them back in again. I would think that we have to conduct it accordingly. It has to be open for 30 days.
Hold on a minute. I don't know why we necessarily have to start the entire cycle over
The 30 days is still running, is it not?
Well, no, I'm comfortable with starting the process over again.
I think we'll start the process over again.
Then I agree.
Yeah, so they can renominate the people.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, like sign. That passes 4-0 with Commissioner Levin absent. For items 3 and 4 together. And now we're on to number 5.
Mr. Chairman, I need to apologize to the board. But I need us to revisit items 3 and 4. And I'll tell you why. You all asked me a question during that discussion about the 30-day process, and I believe I gave you an opinion, having pulled up the ethics ordinance, that there was 30 days for the nominating process. And I feel like that if upon further review, and I'm sitting here staring at it and had time to digest the full paragraph, if I feel like I've gotten it wrong, I need to tell you. So let me tell you why I'm saying what I'm saying. The language says that the group of individuals shall have 30 days in which to conduct their appointment process. My problem is, in speaking with Pat, I know we only got one nomination, for instance, with respect to the employees, but that would typically have involved a vote. So if we're supposed to nominate and vote within 30 days, that's the process, then I think it's, to me, that means it's pretty clear that the nomination process is going to be less than 30. Does that make sense? Because there's supposed to be a nomination and a vote all within 30 days, and we bring the results to you. And I apologize that I messed that up when I just...
How long do we think we need for the election now?
This is the time to define that, because you can't have a one-day nominating period and then close it.
I don't disagree with that.
And then 29 days, you know, or somebody's going to have a
fit. Absolutely. I think that we need to revisit the ordinance and just put this on hold until we can revise the ordinance.
There's no grounds for revising.
There's grounds.
not when they've made a recommendation.
It's confusing.
It is confusing.
They apparently weren't confused by that.
Well, I think they were.
It took Ken 2 times looking.
And he probably tracked.
He just paid not to be confused.
That thing was on a hiatus for how long with that ethics ordinance against him? It's not going to hurt him to take time to get it right. So I would make a motion that we review the ethics ordinance at the next work session. So if we need to clarify, we do so. And I hope it would require public hearings and then go back and have the elections accorded.
I might like to just interject that all previous nomination processes have followed the same process that we have. Not that it says that the previous ones were right, but it does follow the same exact methodology and interpretation of the ethics ordinance.
I think we had it wrong before, and I think we need to get it right.
Second.
All right.
Are we voting again or reconsidering or what?
Well, the motion was to basically reject the nominations and start the process over again.
I think that we need to rescind those and then make a motion to address the ordinance confusion and get it cleared up before we do it again.
Well, if you want to do that, we need to go ahead and make a motion for reconsideration of the previous items.
Can we move my second?
Does it go to public hearing? Okay.
We'll get to that. Let's make the motion for reconsideration first.
I'd like to first make a motion, Counselor, if you don't mind, as a separate issue, that we, at the next work session, have you bring back language that's clear, that lays out very clear steps for nominations and elections, notifications, etc.
Dates.
And that we get that right. I'd like to make that motion first, which I think I can. So that would be my motion.
Well, I'm just going to go ahead and say this then. I am uncomfortable with us. The agenda item is simply the ratification of these two issues. I am sorry. I got it wrong. I did. I mean, it seems to me that it's a 30-day process, not a 30-day nomination window. But what I have heard in the interim is that this is how we've done it for years. And, you know,
yeah, but if we've done it long for years, Counselor, with all due respect, I think you're hearing the board say we want to get it right. I think that's what you're hearing down here.
Well, that's fine. I don't know that it's wrong. Is my problem.
It's confusing.
It's confusing. And I'm not prepared to appoint somebody to a board as important as the ethics board, not knowing if we're following the ethics ordinance to set the ethics board. I think that it's difficult for us to assume that we have it right and perhaps face an ethics complaint that we're not following the ethics ordinance.
I have a suggestion. Maybe we just postpone 3 or 4, and then in the interim direct you to bring this to a public hearing. Then we're not voting down.
When do the present individuals leave?
Well, their term would cease June 30th of this year, 2012.
Okay. We have some time.
I think we have some time to get it right. And I think that we need to bring it to the next work session. I've just asked Cindy if you could just have them, if somebody's okay with it, then we'll put it on the next work session to review those portions of the ethics ordinance and ask Ken to have something prepared for that work session that is very, very clear on what that is.
Well, are we reconsidering this or not?
Do we need to rescind our motion on 3 and 4 first?
We don't. I'm not comfortable, Counselor, if you just want me to say it out loud, rescinding these until we have the other stuff corrected. Because on top of having concerns about the process being followed, I hate to say it publicly, I have some concerns about the individual that's been appointed because he's involved with potential litigation on a very issue that I don't think he should be appointed.
And I'm not trying to get into that. I really am not. I made a call earlier that it was a 30-day nominating process. I'm telling you, I don't read it that way now. And I'm apologizing for the fact that I gave you bad advice.
So I think we need to set this issue get straight and then we'll postpone this.
But I'm also telling you that my HR director is saying this is the process we followed historically. This is the process that's in the ordinance. If you all want to revisit it, I will revisit it. I'm uncomfortable though if we're not going to ratify what the process has produced.
I don't think we can ratify something if we believe it's in conflict with the ordinance or not clear. How do you expect the board to ratify something when we don't know? Just because it's been done before doesn't mean that it's been done correctly.
I'd like to make a motion to reconsider items 3 and 4.
I think we had a motion. How are we doing the other issue? We've gone on the next work session.
Right now it is, yes. Okay. You've given direction for me to bring back language to the next work session on the ordinance.
Is that an outstanding motion?
No,
that wasn't a motion at all. That was just direction.
I just want to make sure there wasn't a motion.
All right,
So a motion to reconsider both items?
Yes.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, like sign. I believe that passes.
And board members, again, I apologize.
Make a motion that we postpone item number 3 and 4 until we get the ethics ordinance resolved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, like sign. Aye. And that passes 3-1 with Commissioner Levent being absent. All right. Sign ordinance number 8.
Ken, sorry about that mix up. I know it's confusing sometimes.
Item number 29.
Mr. Chairman, at the last work session, or it may have been a special meeting. I can't recall if it was the work session or the special meeting, but the board did discuss, I think it was May 22nd, the board did discuss the Forsyth County Ethics Ordinance, and there actually were two issues presented. One of them would be actually the next agenda item. This agenda item, though, pertained to the ordinance itself. with respect particularly to the appointment process. I think the board would like or wanted some additional clarity with respect to the breakdown of time by which basically the pool of individuals who get to nominate a member, and just for purposes of our hypothetical, let's assume it's the employees of the county, once they're notified that there is an open appointment, what does that process look like? We currently have a mechanism that allows basically a 30-day process, and I think the board was interested in having some more specificity as on that process. So what I have done in your agenda, in your agenda book, you will see that the body or individuals notified that there is an opening shall have 20 days from the date of the notification to submit nominations for appointment. So a fairly lengthy amount of time to submit nominations. If more than a single nominee is submitted, a vote shall promptly occur, which shall be conducted per the rules established by the county manager or his or her designee. But in no event shall the vote require more than 10 days to complete. And again, you know, you'll have to look to Ms. Carson as far as how long a vote typically takes to complete, but I think it goes without saying that she can do one within 10 days. So 20 days to nominate, 10 days to take the vote, and then upon the end of that process, which is now sort of set forth with more specificity, then the result of that process, I think within 5 days, comes to the Board of Commissioners at your next regular meeting for consideration. So that's what I've done to the ethics ordinance per the direction on May 22nd.
And if I might, we've talked about a lot of these changes, and we've seen a lot of just we've had to continue to make changes to this ethics board. And there are counties that have moved away from citizens of the county serving on an ethics board and have moved to a procedure that they establish a pool of attorneys that don't live in the county, don't do business in the county, don't practice in the county. 15 or 20 of them agree. They learn our ethics ordinance. And then if there's an ethics complaint filed, there's a method for anonymous selection. Pull their name out of the hat or something for three of them to review an ethics issue.
Yes, I'm aware of those models, yes.
It seems to me that that process removes any friendships, political ties, business ties, supporter ties, any ties to an employee or an elected official. I'd like to ask the board to consider looking at that type of a policy. As we get to be a bigger county, it seems like that might be a great way to address some of these concerns that we have and remove some of the trouble that we've had with it. I don't say trouble, but you know what I mean.
It's a lot to put on a volunteer citizen board sometimes.
Yeah. Well, and it puts people in a really unique position because they have to go to church with people or they're in scouts or whatever they do. I don't know. But what would it take to, I mean, That would be
a, you know, obviously a substantive modification to the board, and I don't take it from your comments at all that anybody is singling out any particular member of the ethics board. I don't hear that at all. I hear this is more just of a bigger picture issue.
Clean it up and be done with it.
It would simply take direction from the Board of Commissioners. I mean, I know those ordinances. I know what they look like. If you have an interest in bringing back a modification, I could either put that language together for you and bring it to a work session, or you could just tell me to go, you want to emulate a model like that and bring it to a public hearing.
Because we have a vacancy, I think we need to just go straight to a public hearing, because it's a pretty clear-cut kind of a thing. And with that type of a, this is secondary, we could probably remove the frivolity thing out of it too.
Have to increase the budget.
Well, yeah, we could, but we can address that issue.
Would we have to pay out an attorney for the ethics board since we're going to have it?
It depends how you would do it. If you picked a pool of attorneys from out of the jurisdiction, you could expect that they would want some fee recovery for the amount of time they spend handling
the
cases.
But would we need an attorney for them, or do they act as their own? sort of. You see what I mean?
Yeah, I think that the need for a hearing officer is lessened when you have folks that
I'm
sort of
save money there.
Do hearings anyway.
I tell you what, I will make a motion and hope it's not inappropriate. I'd like to ask if you would create a new ordinance that looks at that model. I would even go as far as to add to that we remove the frivolity part of it and just move it to a straight three-person panel. They make the call and move on with it. And that if you could go straight to a public hearing, we provide the information beforehand to the commissioners and whoever else wants it, put it on the website or whatever, and just clean it up.
Second.
Commissioners, could that also involve where they don't have to meet on a regular basis if there's nothing to meet on?
No, they would be convened only if there's a complaint filed.
Yes.
The ordinance would specify that there's a pool, I guess.
Perfect.
Somehow the three people would be picked either by the county manager out of a shoebox or something. It could be that simple.
And they, that's right. They're going to convene when we have an issue.
Is that good? Yeah.
Absolutely.
And it removes staff from having to feel the pressure of an ethics complaint and our citizens. I just think it's a great way to go.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0 with Commissioner Tam being absent.
Okay. Commissioners, would you all mind, in light of that, if staff or I or me working with Doug reached out to the current membership just to write them a letter and indicate
this is
parking, just to make sure they're not.
And it's so important that we let them know that this doesn't have any reflection on the service that they have provided. This isn't because of anything they've done or any decisions they've made.
Therefore, are we foregoing the actual item 29?
You know, the actual item 29, let me do this. Since this is a ordinance that will need to be adopted, right now we have an ordinance in place and we have protocols. I mean, I hate to over procedure it. I mean, in light of what you all just did, I can see a really good argument why at least item 29 does not need to be addressed this evening.
What should we do with it procedurally?
Well, we can make a motion to
table it.
Remove it from the agenda. Or how does that, what's the?
It depends what your objective is. If your objective is to simply decide that we don't need to fool with this at all right now, I would just ask that it be withdrawn from the agenda.
Well, that's what we're doing. We actually are making a modification. It's just not the one you recommended.
Right.
Not recommended. I don't mean it that way. It's not the one that we
anticipated.
Right,
it's not the one in the, it's wrong.
Yeah, so we did take action on it.
But we need to. Do we need to
I would dare say we did not take action.
Mr. Chairman, I make a motion that we withdraw item 29 from the agenda in light of the previous vote.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. That passes 4-0 with Commissioner Tam being absent. Item 30, appointment to the Ethics Board. You added that, Ken?
Yeah, Mr. Chairman, procedurally, I've just got to catch up real quick, and forgive me, Commissioner Bell, that's my fault. I don't think, whatever the outcome we need to do on 29, I'm not convinced that withdrawing item 29 is what needs to happen, because it states its proposed modification to the Forsyth County Ethics Ordinance, and you all just did direct a modification to the Forsyth County Ethics Ordinance.
That's what I originally suggested, that we did do it, we just did not.
Yeah.
So
I would ask a
I'm going to make a motion we rescind.
To reconsider.
To reconsider the withdrawal from the agenda.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to, this is a vote to reconsider?
Yes, sir.
To reconsider. If there's no discussion, please vote on the motion. That passes 4-0 with Commissioner Tam.
And for clarity, we did address 29.
My request would be that there be a motion to take no action with respect to the proposed modification to the nomination process.
So moved.
Second.
A motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion, which passes 4-0 with Commissioner Tan being absent.
It even gets late for our counselor.
Yes.
Item 30. With all due respect,
as excellent as he is.
With respect to issue number 30, Mr. Chairman, may I go ahead and go? We still have the fruit of a nomination process. And I'm mindful of the action we just took with respect to potentially reconfiguring the entirety of the board, but I do think we have the product of that process, and I would respectfully request that we act upon it to close it. Is the board currently have a quorum that's functioning?
Yes, if the individuals that whose term is finishing are willing to stay on per the ordinance until a new appointee is made or modification is done.
The individual we're here about this evening is the employee's nominee. Who is the other individual that's up?
The elected official's nominee. So there are two.
We asked them to stay on, then tell them what we're doing, see if it would serve an extra
stay
two or three
for
months.
A couple, 2 or 3 months, yeah.
Well, you could. Here's my problem with that, and it's not a problem. It's just that we've implemented a process, and we have the product of the process.
Why can we make a motion to not appoint the last person and ask that the current member serve?
You can do that, but I guess you could do that. But my thought is I mean, we don't know that this reconfiguration we're going to do on the ethics ordinance will work. We don't know that it'll be adopted. It may, and it likely will, but we don't know that. I mean, we're either going to need to take a yes or no on the current nomination that's in front of you, or we need, and if it's yes, that individual serves until such time as the Board of Ethics is dispensed with.
Who is the elected official's current appointee? And the new one is? Phil Bettis. In light of what we're doing, I would make a motion that we not ratify either appointee, if I have to make them separate or together.
Well, right now, I think it's only the employee's nominee, so just go ahead and stick with
that.
And
I would make a motion that we not ratify the employee nomination for the appointment to the Ethics Board, and that we ask Ms. Carson to reach out to the current appointee to see if they'll continue serving.
Well, before and before that seconded, and I don't mean to, well, forgive me, I'm out of order. Go ahead and see if it gets seconded.
Can you say the name? Who is the candidate, or who is the Pat?
Nominee.
Who
Charlie
is the
Laughinghouse.
Oh, okay.
She said Phil.
Yeah. Okay. We have a motion. Do we have a second?
Can you repeat that motion?
If appropriate, the motion would be to not ratify the current nomination, or and to ask Ms. Carson to ask the current appointee to stay on for a couple of months until we get through with this modification.
Would that be for the purpose of just not nominating somebody for like a 30-day window, which would be,
yeah.
I mean, because why would you do that, I guess?
Well, again, the person there's got some experience, and why would we nominate somebody that has, I just don't see it's
30 days.
We're looking 30 days. Modifying the board.
Yeah, okay.
Has it been seconded?
Second.
But my respectful request is it not ratifying the pick, the functional equivalent of denying the pick? And if that's the case, because the individual there will continue in their holdover capacity anyway.
Right.
So is that, forgive me, is that your motion?
I don't want to make an appointment and just let the person there just continue on. That's my goal.
For a couple
of months.
I understand that, but aren't you declining, or isn't the motion really to, reject is too hard, but you understand what I'm saying, to decline the appointment?
Yes, to not ratify, to decline.
Okay, forgive me, I don't mean to belabor it, I'm just trying to make sure I've got closure so there's been action. Thank you.
A second, all right?
Yes, sir.
You have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 3-1 with Commissioner Tam being absent.
Item number 5, County Attorney.
Mr. Chairman, item number 5 is a first reading of proposed modification to the Forsyth County Ethics Code, Ordinance number 77. This is a fairly substantive modification to our code that will disband the Forsyth County Ethics Board as we know it, and will replace it with a new operational methodology. wherein a sitting board will no longer exist. It will be replaced by an ethics panel that will be assembled on a case-by-case basis. It will be assembled, or the assembly will be comprised of three individuals that will be maintained on file. These will be attorneys. These will be attorneys that are all have offices out of the county, and otherwise is set forth with some specificity, can have no affiliation or basically connections to Forsyth County. There will be a pool of these attorneys that will be sort of qualified every year. The pool must be no less than 9 or more than 15. The minimum qualifications for the attorneys are set forth in Section 2 of the code, and whenever the county receives an ethics complaint, there will basically be a blind drawing of three from this pool that will then be comprised or to form the ethics panel. That ethics panel will then hold the hearing or conduct the hearing in a manner that is similar to how we have conducted or allowed hearings to occur in the past. So that is sort of the big picture, the paradigm shift, if you will. We still will have an opportunity for the ethics panels to issue advisory opinions. That is the one accommodation. You know, right now we've got a sitting ethics board that can issue an advisory opinion. Well, if someone wants an advisory opinion under our ethics code, you could assemble one of these ethics panels. Now, a couple things to think about. Number one, in Section 6, members of these ethics panels will be paid a per diem for each meeting or hearing, and they will be provided that per diem for each day of the hearing, and that per diem will be approved by the Board of Commissioners. And it may be that we want to approve that in advance so that you're not approving per diems on a case-by-case basis, but sort of set one for the year, and that's the model that we use. A lot of the language in this proposed modification you have seen before, and it is the same. Some of the powers of the ethics panel will be different than the Board of Ethics. For instance, in Section 7, we're not going to have the ethics panels establish procedures, rules, and regulations governing its internal organization. Quite frankly, since they're set up on an ad hoc case-by-case basis, it makes a lot less sense to do that. Also, as to number three, under Section 7 duties, the ethics board may make investigations as it deems necessary to determine whether any violation is violated this article, etc. Not only am I unaware of that ever happening before, but of course that makes a lot less sense with a ad hoc ethics panel that's assembled on a case-by-case basis. They're just, practically speaking, would be no opportunity for them to launch their own investigation. They will be truly a tribunal set up to hear case-by-case ethics complaints. The only other significant thing that I want to bring to your attention is the fact that if you were to approve this ethics panel concept, the board has also authorized me to also strike Section 17, which was the wrongful use provisions of the ethics code. Those are the provisions that said that if there was an ethics complaint that was found to be frivolous, etc., there would be a cost-shifting mechanism to go against the complaining party. That would be stricken in its entirety. The code would still contain that methodology whereby someone that had drawn a complaint, an elected official or a county employee, if they prevail, can seek to have their attorney's fees paid by the county. That would still remain. But the notion of being able to seek cost shifting against the complaining party, if this is adopted as I have drafted it, that goes away. All of it. Mr. Chairman, this is the first public reading this evening. The board cannot adopt this evening. Thank you.
Is there a motion from the board to open the public hearing?
I'll move. Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote. And that passes unanimously. Is there anyone who wishes to speak in favor of the proposed amendments to the Forsyth County Ethics Ordinance?
Good evening, Commissioners. Well, that's some nice ties y'all are wearing up there. It's casual even for the rest of the world out here. My name's Brent Meadows. I have a little bit of experience with ethics. I, like Commissioner Tim, had an ethics complaint filed and subsequently it was dismissed for technical errors. I'm a little bit concerned that we're going to remove the ability of this board to do an investigation on their own. If there is a proposal or a complaint that's made and it's dismissed on technical errors, I think that the panel should be able to make a determination, well, the technical errors here do prevent us from moving ahead, but we see something and we want to investigate further, and then their hands would be tied. So I think that's very important for you to do that. Hold on 1 second. No, Mr. Mayor, I can't tell them that. But other than that, I'm in favor of this ordinance, and I hope that you'll consider a passage with a few modifications to allow that board to be able to do some further investigations if they deem necessary because of some technical deficiencies. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there anyone else wishing to speak in favor?
Hello, Commissioners. I'm Dan Wolf. I was on the first ethics panel and take that issue very much to heart. I see some wisdom in the changes being proposed. I have a question. Was there any discussion about whether or not we could have a couple of people within the residents of Forsyth County that would also serve with the three attorneys from outside the county? So that's the question I have. And I wonder if perhaps that brings some local wisdom, maybe. And yet, even as I say that, I can realize that, you know, we're trying to separate local undue influence from an ethics issue. So, you know, there's a downside to that. But I'm just wondering.
You? Anyone else?
Good evening, Commissioners. My name is Nydia Tisdale. I live in Muswell, Georgia. I think this is a wonderful idea, this ethics panel that you're considering. One thing I would suggest is that in addition to complaints, in the case of one particular commissioner who wondered if they did in fact have a conflict of interest, they were able to go to the ethics board and get a review, an opinion, an advisory opinion. So I would suggest that the ethics panel have that authority to be able to render an opinion as well. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Any other comments? If not, is there a motion to close the public hearing?
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes unanimously. Ken, do you have any comments?
No, just to, with respect to Mr. Wolf's concern, to the extent that you were to contemplate expanding the panels to add some local citizens, certainly that could be done. Y'all will need to consider that. I will just say that's what we are coming away from. I think the notion would be that if you had the outside influence, that perhaps it would mitigate any concerns about that.
I think that was one of the reasons I had asked to do this, because we want to remove that. The pressure put on local citizens when they've been friends and family and supporters and employees and family works here and all those. And that, when we heard about it in another jurisdiction, I was the one to brought it forward and say, this is a great idea to do here. And Mr. Wolf, I think that is, it's nice to have people participate, but in this particular instance, I think it's better to have disinterested people reviewing it.
With respect to the advisory opinions, that tool is still in the code of the draft with respect to this ethics panel. And finally, with respect to the independent investigation or independent investigative powers, that could be reinserted. There's no particular reason that was taken out. That was not a specific direction from the board. Just as in drafting it and taking away a standing board, the way I was reading that was something that the standing board would have the ability to do. I really hadn't contemplated that the ethics panel might find a concern they wanted to investigate and just didn't feel like they had the tools to do it. So if you want to consider that.
That's another issue. I don't believe that the ethics panel is a police panel. It's more of a review panel. If it's a technical issue, the complaining party certainly can be filed a complaint. So I would not support that. We, you know, the judge and jury don't go out and investigate crimes. They just listen to the evidence. And that's where I feel this board, this panel needs to be. I need to be at least.
But we can't take any action.
That's correct, Mr. Chairman.
So that, no objection from anyone going to item number six.
We've closed the public hearing, have we not?
Yes, we have.
Thank you.
Item number five.
Thank you. This request is to confirm the reappointments to the Board of Ethics of three of its members, Mr. Lorne Twyer, as the Civil Service Board's appointment. That would commence August the 3rd, 2012. Mr. Tim Perry, the elected official's appointment, commencing July the 2nd, 2012. And Mr. Rusty Ricketson, the employee's appointment, commencing 7-2-2012. I understand that the ethics ordinance is in the process of being reviewed and changed, but felt that it'd be important to have this for the board so that the appointment could at least be applied for the interim until such time the ethics ordinance is approved.
Just to add to what Ms. Carson just said, you know, certainly we had sent correspondence to the existing ethics board basically asking that they stay on irrespective of their terms ending, just as holdover, given what the Board of Commissioners was doing with respect to the ethics ordinance. I just felt that it was important for Pat to continue processing things in the ordinary course, bringing this to you. But I would be very comfortable if you all, having heard this, still wanted to postpone till the October work session, simply because this all may become moot the first public hearing in October if you in fact decide to approve the new ethics board configuration.
To the first postpone to
October 9th.
So moved. Postpone item 5 to October 9th.
Second. Postponing item number 5 to October 9th. We have a motion of second. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Against? Bar none. Passes 3-0.
Item number 3, reappointments of the Board of Ethics.
Yes, Commissioner, this request for their confirm the reappointments of three of the Board of Ethics had been postponed from the 9:25 work session to today. You may also postpone it if you so desire, but it is for the reappointments of Tim Perry, Rusty Ricketson, and Lauren Twiner.
Remember, board members, this was something we had postponed to the last work session in anticipation of the potential ethics rules being approved at the first meeting in October. Since they were postponed till November, this came back up again. And
basically, these folks would just serve until that meeting.
Until it's potentially approved on November 1st. I was sort of an advocate of getting these on the agenda just because in the ordinary course that's how we would have done it. Mm-hmm. But I'm mindful that we're about to negate the whole reason for that, potentially. Mm-hmm. They did. Yes.
So we need
a morning.
One at a time, or can we just put them all in the same time?
Go ahead and appoint them all at once, if you choose to.
Chairman, I make a motion we confirm the reappointments to the Board of Ethics, Mr. Will McCormick, Mr. Tim Perry, Mr. Leslie Ricketson, and as presented, the personal terms.
Second.
The motion we have second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. Those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed, like sign. That passes unanimously. Any other changes?
Mr. Chairman, I would respect your request under the consent agenda, item 2B, board confirmation of reappointments to the Board of Ethics. I believe we may need to have just a little bit of discussion about that. Our rules provide any two commissioners may request that an item on consent agenda go to
somewhere else on the agenda like old business, I would request there be a motion and second to remove that item to old business and at least let me talk to you about it.
I'll move.
So we're removing item 2B from the consent agenda.
That's correct. That's correct.
Old business number 4.
Yes, sir. That's fine. It'd actually be out of three. It'd be three since the two postponements.
Be three.
Yes, sir.
Aye.
No votes required.
The item from consent agenda B.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, yes, that item was the confirmation of reappointments to the Board of Ethics of Tim Perry, Rusty Ricketson, and Lauren Twiner. The reason that I had requested this come off the consent agenda was because Mr. Perry has delivered correspondence asking or basically resigning for a host of reasons, not the least of which is he may be serving actually on another board of the county. I've also heard that Mr. Ricketson may do the same thing. In light of that, and also in light of the public hearing that will occur in November with respect to the potential reconfiguration of the ethics board, rather than confirm these individuals this evening, I would just request that we postpone once again this whole Board of Ethics reappointment process to the first work session in November, which would be November 6th.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion. We have a second. If there's no discussion, please vote on the motion. That passes unanimously.
We either got to amend it and configure our panels, or we need to set this aside, or at least go ahead and get those pending matters, those pending positions filled, so the Board of Ethics can act. Because right now they can't. I don't even know that there's a quorum left for the remaining, which is barely a quorum, but quite frankly, we need a fully constituted.
Can we move until the 15th with that?
Get it going then?
The public hearing? Move the public hearing to the 15th? We could do that, but yes, the answer is yes. We can move it to the 15th, but for purposes of this matter that's pending, I think at your work session on Tuesday, we're going to have to go ahead and see if we can get some folks to fill in for one more time. I mean, we're getting precariously close to, you know, not having, you know, or committing some sort of a procedural issue with respect to those folks that are that individual that's waiting for that preliminary meeting of the board.
I didn't know that, Councilor, but I'm
that's fair. I don't know that you did. Yeah.
So I'll move until the 15th. I'll make a motion to move to the 15th. We need to reconsider my previous motion.
You do. You'll need to reconsider the motion to postpone public hearing item 4.
So move.
Second.
We have a motion. We have a second. Motion.
Now we need to move to postpone item public hearing number 4 to the November 15th meeting.
Second.
We have a motion, we have a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote. And then that's unanimous. We are on to item number 1.
Mr. Chairman.
Yeah, no, that's okay. We're both working on it.
Yeah, Mr. Chairman, members of the board, this is an item that's been postponed a couple times. You know, in the ordinary course, when terms of appointed officials expire, we bring them back to you, obviously, either to renew them or to have new individuals put on those various boards. This pertains to the Ethics Board, which presently, the Ethics Ordinance is in a situation where it's been specially set to November 15th for a second and potentially final public hearing, wherein we may set up a new paradigm for how we handle ethics complaints. Therefore, we have sort of been keeping these reappointments in limbo in anticipation of us, you know, reconfiguring how the Ethics Board works. So it's really up to the board what you want to do with this. Now, I do think it belongs on the agenda. I do think that until we have modified how the Ethics Board or the composition of the Ethics Board, we have to at least keep this ball juggling in the air. But a little bit of it depends upon what you want to do. And here's the only wrinkle. The only wrinkle is we have a pending ethics complaint. It was tendered on October 19th, and the deadlines that we're under, there's 30 days by which the subject of the ethics complaint can file or tender a response. Within 60 days, or basically by December 18th of this year, there has to be an investigatory review by the Board of Ethics. Well,
we don't have any, you know, we're going to have trouble impaneling a Board of Ethics until we either get a new system set up or we get some of these individuals filled. We have, I think we have confirmation that Mr. Perry has declined to continue serving in a either a holdover or a new capacity. And I believe Mr. Ricketson has given sort of the same, at least maybe verbal, advice or information. So I'm not even sure that we have an operational quorum right now. And so I need some help a little bit with respect to that.
One thing to also just bring up is that the ordinance also states that they will have a meeting sometime in November. And even if that was scheduled for the last part of November, we still have to advertise seven business days for the Open Meetings Act.
Just for a regular business, regular course?
Yes, for the ordinance.
We have to have an election. We have to have a 10-day announcement, 20-day election, 20-day announcement for the employees' appointment.
I agree. The only thing we might be able to do, if you want to have this panel hear the present complaint, is we might just reach out to them and ask them to continue serving in a holdover capacity.
Well, I think that's something we need to do. I mean, if they've declined to, we can't really reaffirm if they've declined at this point.
I concur.
So, want to reach out?
Just touch, ask them and see if they just hear this one complaint.
One last.
And that should be it.
And if they, all they have to do is make a decision is if it's to be heard or not, and then it can then get into the cycle of whatever you guys decide to do. Can we send it to the state board of ethics? Do we have that ability?
We probably couldn't do that. I mean, I think we're left with two options, and I think Commissioner Bell's right with respect to particularly the process by which we would have to bring in, if we have to put in a new employee's representative, that's going to take some time. I think that if we can't assemble a quorum, I think then the complaint would probably fail if we can't meet our own protocols. So what I'll do is Pat and I'll work together. We'll reach out, see if we can get some feedback. These people will serve one last time.
So what happens when you beat people up publicly and they volunteer to do this stuff with their own good and they get absolutely lambasted by activists? They don't want to do it. But here we are.
Well, but their terms have expired also. As if they've stepped out of the room.
Well, they don't. Well, no, they don't want
to. We
don't want to do it. As far as I understand.
I don't need any action. I understand.
Okay. Item number two, adoption of the agenda. Are there any changes to the agenda? Do you have any changes?
Mr. Chairman, I do. I have two. First of all, with respect to a matter of some time sensitivity, I would request the board add as new business item three a proposed resolution that would reassemble the ethics board for the purpose of hearing the pending ethics matter. Just because we've got a pending ethics complaint, we need to get that done. I have passed out a proposed resolution to your stations. And that would take 4/5, Mr. Chairman, to add that.
So moved. Second.
We have a motion. We have a second for a time-sensitive item. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes unanimously. Item number two, regarding...
I thought we were addressing this at the end of the agenda.
Mr. Tang, we are addressing the resolution regarding the current Board of Ethics at the end of the agenda, but that's different than the ordinance itself. Mr. Chairman, do you want me to go ahead and proceed?
Yes, please.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, public hearing number two this evening is what will be the second public hearing related to Forsyth County Ethics Ordinance, which is Ordinance Number 77, and it proposed fairly significant modification thereof. This has been in the works for some time, and really, I don't need to go give you a 15-20-minute presentation. I can distill it fairly quickly. This would effectively, once this is adopted, it would disband the existing standing ethics board as it currently exists and would replace
replace it with an ad hoc panel of out-of-county attorneys that would comprise an ethics panel that would be assembled on a case-by-case basis every time an ethics complaint is tendered. We would use some models that have been done in other jurisdictions. We would get basically names of attorneys that have offices outside of Forsyth County. We would have them on standby. When an ethics complaint comes in, there would be a process of basically randomly selecting a panel of three and then assembling those individuals. They would come together. They would hear the complaint very much in the ordinary course that is done now, and they would render their decision. The hope is that this will take any potential element of conflict of interest or associational source of interests out of the ethics equation altogether. That's the background for this. With respect to their powers, one significant thing is that this proposed ordinance would take away the existing Board of Ethics right to conduct investigations. This ethics panels would not be empowered to do that. They won't be standing. It will be complaint-based only and then adjudicate those complaints. The other significant modification is this would strike from our code what is in our code now, which is the wrongful use section. Right now, there is in our ethics code that if there is in fact a dismissal of a complaint or a complaint that is deemed to be frivolous, it would result in a potential wrongful use finding based upon, I think, clear and convincing evidence. It's a fairly high standard, but can actually allow fee shifting to go against the party that made the complaint. If this is adopted as it is currently drafted today, that wrongful use ordinance would go away. This would be our second public hearing, Mr. Chairman, the Board of Commissioners could adopt. And to go back to Commissioner Tam's point, even if you adopt this evening and therefore this becomes the law, I am still going to request that we approve a resolution assembling the old assemblage of our Board of Ethics to hear a complaint that is pending right now. There's a couple of reasons for that. I'll explain it when we get to that in the agenda, but I just want to let you know in case we get to that point, you're like, why did this happen? I'll explain it then. Mr. Chairman, this is the second public hearing. You can adopt.
Thank you. Is there a motion from the board?
Mr. Chairman, I make a motion. Do we approve?
Oh, wait. Do I need to open a public
hearing? Yes, have right here.
Yeah. Yes, sir. Chair, would entertain a motion to open the public hearing.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote. And that passes unanimously. Is there anyone wishing to speak in favor of this proposed amendment? Is there anyone wishing to speak in opposition? Is there anyone wishing to say anything about it at all? If not, is there a motion to close the public hearing?
So moved. Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote. And that passes unanimously.
Mr. Chairman, I make a motion that we approve the motion as to the Forsyth County Ethics Ordinance as described by the county attorney.
Second.
We have a motion. We have a second. There's no further discussion. We vote on the motion. And that passes unanimously. I see we added an item regarding the ethics board.
Mr. Chairman, we did. This next item added by motion both this evening on the constitutional basis was a resolution of the Board of Commissioners acknowledging the holdover terms of certain ethics board members and acknowledging withdrawal of a resignation of a single ethics board member for purposes of concluding a pending ethics complaint. And I will say this, Mr. Chairman, I am mindful that the Board of Commissioners has modified the ethics code effective, quite frankly, this after this evening. But we have a pending ethics matter filed under the terms of the old ethics ordinance. And quite frankly, for a number of reasons, it would make sense to go ahead and have the old board adjudicate and preside over that matter. This resolution would do a couple things. First of all, it would acknowledge the makeup of the Board of Ethics as it existed previously. It would acknowledge the holdover capacity of three of the board members. It would acknowledge the waiver of the resignation of Mr. Perry such that he can serve for this final matter. And it would therefore allow them to assemble as quickly as possible to hold the November meeting and then go ahead and hear that last complaint. Also, the ethics attorney, Mr. Logan Butler, has accused from this matter, and this resolution would also appoint Attorney George Weaver, who the ethics board has used previously as the hearing officer for this last ethics adjudication.
I should point out that a lot of what the Board of Commissioners has done this evening, it's just not academic. This will be the last time they adjudicate. It is official that this will be the last matter they will hear, because once their service on this matter is completed, they will be dissolved as a matter of law. Mr. Chairman, I would ask your gracious indulgence of my fourth whereas paragraph, where it states, whereas the pending ordinance has not been placed into lawful effect. If the Board of Commissioners adopts this evening, I would ask that you strike that fourth paragraph, because you have, in fact, adopted the new ordinance. That's my recommendation.
Thank you, Counselor.
The fourth paragraph in the whereas, folks, that's the one that needs to come out.
What's the pleasure of the board?
Make a motion we adopt a resolution of Forsyth County Board of Commissioners acknowledging the holdover terms of certain ethics board members and acknowledging the withdrawal of their resignations of a single ethics member board for the purpose of conducting a final pending ethics matter of those other purposes as displayed, striking the fourth paragraph.
Second. We have a motion, we have a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote. That passes unanimously. Counselors, is there any other business to come before this board?
There is not, Mr. Chairman. Not on the executive session this evening.
Thank you. What we want. Is there a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second. We have a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote. That passes unanimously. So, can we go on to the next item, which is 29?
Very quickly, Mr. Chairman, I'll take this one. January 3rd is the first Thursday of the new year. The local act creating Forsyth County provides that the Board of Commissioners shall hold a regular meeting on the first and third Thursday of the month. As a result, that would mean that this board, albeit perhaps briefly, does in fact need to assemble on January 3rd. A couple of folks have reached out to me and said, what can we do? A lot of kids are going to be out of school yet. A lot of folks may be traveling. Quite frankly, a lot of our citizens may not be engaged. Otherwise, we want to be a part of that meeting. You know, that is the meeting typically where our officers are elected. That's the meeting where our rules are adopted. And quite frankly, a lot of citizens that might not even be in town may want to be at that meeting. My recommendation to you is, let's do assembled. I would say a skeleton crew of three board members literally can come together, open a meeting, postpone every agenda item to a specially called meeting on January 8th, and then adjourn. It would take approximately 2 minutes. You will have fulfilled the literal requirement of your local rules, then you can go home, and no citizen will therefore not, you know, have missed the meeting.
So you're talking maybe about a 2 minute meeting, or if I'm looking at the agenda, I mean, it's not a very long meeting. It could be a very short meeting anyway.
That's true. I mean, if you wanted to go ahead and assemble and do a half hour's worth of work, we could do that. I don't mean to suggest that's not an option. Of course, that's the easy option. I just thought if there was some folks that wanted to be at that meeting, if we're electing officers, they may want to be at that meeting. If they're traveling, this would get, and plus to talk about it now would give all our citizens, you know, Alyssa could talk about it in paper, perhaps.
Right, and not much to sit in the meeting.
Yeah, no, because you thought that because all these folks might not be here, they might be in the middle, but you're pretty solid on you have to be here to get to this.
And I apologize, yes.
Yeah, if we go on assembly, we might have.
Yeah, but the public can't be here. The ones that want to be here and they're out of town with their families, it's not just about us. Of course, we're here, we should do it. It's about having a meeting where they're going to be back in town. And you're through the 4th on our schools are out, which means then you have your weekend, so they're really not back possibly until the 7th.
And remember, if you're out of the jurisdiction, you can call in so long as we have a physical quorum assembled and you can participate as a member, including voting.
How many times a year? Once?
Twice.
Twice?
Twice.
You need to save yours.
You already used some of mine.
Okay, so that's a great motion. I missed one last year, I didn't get
one. Yeah, you missed one. You said one.
Again, what is?
No, you're not there.
What is your first question?
Cindy, you be around on the 3rd?
I will. If I'm going to be here, I'm like Brian. I just said have a meeting.
You know what?
Yeah, my side page. Go ahead and have it over. You going to be here, Jim?
I may call in, I may not. We'll see how my family feels. They may be done hanging out with me for that long.
Just don't be riding a motorcycle.
12 hours.
I won't do it on that one.
If they've spent more than 12 hours continuously.
Do we need a motion back, Council?
We don't. Regular meeting just goes off without a hitch, then that's fine.